Okay, Houston, as I stand out here in the wonders of the unknown in Hadley, I realize there's a fundamental truth to our nature. Man must explore.
One of the things you got to stop and do, make sure, is to have fun, too. Because you're only probably going to come this way once.
I was strolling on the moon one day in a merry month of December. Now, May, when much to my surprise, a pair of bunny eyes.
Boy, this is a neat way to travel.
Isn't it great?
Dum-da-dum-dum-dum.
I like to skip along.
Not me, boy. Skip.
Or whatever you call it. I can't get my left leg in front of me.
It was almost dangerous. And you lose sight of the fact that it's a vacuum out there, and if you sprang a leak next to it, you're going to be dead.
Uh-oh. I saw Navy landing.
Yahoo!
Oh.
Ah.
Boy, do I like to run up here.
I'm going out for the ballet when I get back. You learn another line of work up here.
Yeah, while you're bouncing around there, you might keep an eye out for a nearby crater.
All right.
I've been on my knees twice to get back.
John?
Yes, sir.
You are black from the knees down.
No way to avoid it. That's why I'm glad the pressure suit bends.
John, you are filthy.
I tell you, there's a pot calling the kettle black. Hey, here's a rock that'd be glad to see it, Houston.
Man, Tony, you don't know how much fun this has been.
We concur, John.
April 16, 1972. Apollo 16, man's fifth lunar landing, sat silently on the pad awaiting its mission. Inside the astronaut quarters, its relaxed crew ate Sunday breakfast. John Young, the veteran of three previous space flights, was commander. Ken Mattingly, command module pilot, would conduct orbital experiments around the moon, while Charles Duke explored the lunar surface with Young. April 22nd. Young and Duke would find themselves strapped into a small electric car called the Rover, bouncing across the lunar plateau known as Descartes.
The old water bag is working super. This is going to be a good day, Charlie.
Yeah! Woo! Man, that was a great. Big skid. We're doing 10 clicks, Tony.
Covered me with dust on that one.
As Young and Duke rode the bucking rover to the lunar formation called Stone Mountain, NASA geologist Farouk Elbaz wrote on a blackboard on Earth, "There is nothing so far removed from us to be beyond our reach, or so hidden that we cannot discover it." René Descartes. As John Young would later remark, Apollo 16 would certainly help prove that René Descartes was right.
Almost like a freshly plowed field that's been rained on.
Yet less than 2 days before, it looked as though this would never happen. It was, in Young's words, a real cliffhanger. The Marshall Space Flight Center team was working on a launch vehicle gyroscope problem that threatened to scrub the mission. Less than an hour before liftoff, their advisory to the Kennedy Space Center launch team was go. Liftoff had been perfect. During the three-day flight to lunar orbit, the problems encountered had been more annoyances than critical, such as paint flaking off the lunar module, and later a jammed antenna in one of the lunar module's several communication systems. All in all, it had been a quiet flight. April 19th. The burn into lunar orbit was right on.
Hello, Houston. Suite 16 has arrived.
Ryan, this is Houston. How do you read? The subsequent maneuvers all went without a hitch. Then the next day, April 20th, Young and Duke undocked the lunar module preparatory to landing, leaving Mattingly in the command module. The next maneuver was for Mattingly to burn the main engine of his spacecraft to put it into a circular orbit. But as the lunar module emerged from behind the moon...
No, sir. Copy, no, sir.
No, sir. No, sir.
No, sir. In preparing for the circularization burn, Mattingly had found apparent uncontrolled oscillations in the main engine's backup control system. Following mission rules, he did not make the burn.
How long do you think it's going to take him to get rendezvous, Jerry?
I think your estimate of a couple of three res. Yeah.
With the backup system having trouble, only the primary system was known to be usable on the engine needed to get the astronauts out of lunar orbit and back to Earth. However, the lunar module engines could be used if the two spacecraft were docked. The first step in the problem-solving technique, stabilize the situation in the safest manner. Get the two spacecraft, which had separated, close enough together to dock if necessary.
Have to get them back together, get the things back that they want them, get them mentally prepared to do what they're going to do.
But now, don't take that as input. I'm talking out loud. I want to say something else I'm sure of.
I don't see any way we can continue on.
At that moment, the chances for a landing looked pretty slim. But you look at a problem step by step. Step one underway, you look at step two. Analyze the problem as completely as possible within the time frame.
We should make sure that that's gone, but there's no way,
we don't have any other redundancy or other routes.
And in lunar orbit, Mattingly flew the command module to a rendezvous as Young talked him in.
Okay, Ryan, why don't you tell me what to do there, John?
Okay.
Word's coming back kind of initially from North American that they're suspecting a rate feedback.
Building 45 is Jim McDivitt.
The team was coming up to speed, not only at the manned spacecraft center, but from MIT in Massachusetts to North American in Southern California. Isolate the trouble, simulate it, evaluate it.
You can't use it if you get a broken wire. You don't know it's going to come back again.
You sound like I'm drifting the other way.
Not according to my needles.
Okay, I'll believe your needles.
Of course, then you would have had no options.
Okay. Go ahead.
I mean, then it's full speed ahead.
I just don't much see how we can make it on this next trip. I think you guys ought to continue to work.
You'd only do it if you had a failure on the primary. Well, how would you ever get the damn thing trimmed then?
I would. If I had a failure in a primary, I'd shut it down.
Well, we must be going in the right direction then.
We
Yeah, you're going to get there.
Really? Yeah, but I want you guys to go simulate.
Isolate, simulate, evaluate. The results were coming in. It was beginning to pay off. The simulator tests and other data were showing that with the engine on, the oscillations would do no harm. Despite the earlier pessimism, it was beginning to look pretty good.
Okay, when you come up on AOS, on the next rev, rev 15, we'll give you a go or no go for another try.
Manned Spacecraft Center Director, Dr. Christopher C. Kraft, Jr., just came back into the control center after having attended a meeting by management people in one of the back rooms, and the situation is go for landing.
Well, have at it, babe, so we're going to try.
You do have a go for another try here at the PDI on Rev 16.
Once more, they would pass behind the moon. And on the next revolution, John Young and Charlie Duke would start their swift descent to the Descartes Plateau.
Okay, filter initialization looks good.
Bravo, look, feel that beauty, come on.
200, pro.
Pitch over.
Huh? And here it is, Gators, Lone Star.
Call me the thing, Charlie.
Okay, 40 degrees, 38 degrees.
Right.
Helmet on dot, north ray.
Okay.
Looks like we're going to be able to make it, John. There's not too many blocks up there.
Ryan, you go for landing.
Right now looks pretty good.
Looking good. Okay, 76%, plenty fat. Contact. Stop. Boom. Wow! Ryan is finally here, Houston. Fantastic.
The original plan had called for Young and Duke to get out and explore shortly after landing. However, the near abort had lasted 6 hours. The tired astronauts would sleep. April 21. Mission Commander John Young stepped onto the Descartes formation, 11:58 a.m. Eastern Standard Time.
They are mysterious and unknown Descartes. Pilot planes. Apollo 16 is going to change your image.
While their activities were monitored by Mission Control, Young and Duke were also observed by scientists, located across the hall in the science support room. After unloading the rover from its storage bay in the lunar module, they planted the flag.
Hey, John, this is perfect with the limb and the rover and you and Stone Mountain and the old flag. Come on out here and give me a salute. Big Navy salute. Off the ground, one more. There we go.
Best.
Young set up an ultraviolet camera to provide the first astronomical observations from the moon. He took pictures of the Earth's upper atmosphere and magnetosphere and their interaction with the solar wind. He also photographed the interstellar gas present throughout space and the ultraviolet halos that appear around galaxies. Astronomers have long wanted a telescope on the moon. Perhaps this experiment would show the moon an ideal base for future astronomical observations.
You want two pans?
Yeah, we would like two pans. John said...
I'm not leaning on it.
Duke drilled a hole into which a heat flow probe was to be placed, part of one of the experiments attached to the station. As Duke drilled, Young set up the central station and the remainder of the experiments. Then, what many considered the biggest disappointment of the mission.
Probably just some rocks down there in the regolith, Tony. You know, it looks, I bet it's just like the side of that fresh crater we saw back near the limb.
Charlie?
What?
Something happened here.
What happened?
I don't know.
there's a line that pulled loose. What line is it?
That's the heat flow. Pulled it off.
Kind of sorry. I didn't even know it.
Well, that means you've got to mate all those wires, separate wires in there, and have them insulated from one another.
That's right.
And if that doesn't occur, what are the chances of shorting out the central station?
Well, that's another one that they're working.
On Earth, they tried to figure a way to fix the heat flow. On the moon, the astronauts continued with the other experiments. Young placed a series of sensors in the soil, then fired explosive charges, mapping the lunar subsurface much as geologists on Earth use explosives to search for oil.
4, 3, 2, 1, 5.
Stuck in the ground and
I'm trying to get this
over now.
They continue to sample the area and activate the experiments. Then they returned to the rover and prepared for their first trip away from the landing site in search for geological samples.
And here we go.
Their first traverse would take them about 1 kilometer west of the landing site. They would make 2 stops to collect samples and conduct experiments.
10529 in your flight plan.
Okay. But it couldn't pick a better spot.
John, you're just beautiful. That is the most beautiful sight.
What's that?
You're standing there on the rim of that crater.
This guy, I don't really know. You're
going to have to use a hammer.
Young used a portable instrument to measure the local magnetic field. He would later record the most intense magnetic field ever found on the moon. Far higher than scientists ever suspected.
What's that, Charlie?
It's really some crater.
As you come around there, there's a rock in the near field on this rim that has some white on the top of it. We'd like you to pick it up as a grab sample.
This one right here?
That's it.
This one right here?
That's it. You got it right there.
Okay, we copy that.
There would be one more stop before they got back to the lunar module to close out this EVA. With Duke acting as photographer and Young as driver, they put the rover through a full test.
Man, you are really bouncing.
Is he on the ground at all?
That's 10 kilometers.
Huh? He's got about 2 wheels on the ground. Okay, turn sharp.
I have no desire to turn sharp. Okay, here's his sharpie.
Hey, that's great. He's a big rooster tail out of all 4 wheels. And as he turns, he skids. The back end breaks loose just like on snow. Come on back, John. Hey, the deck is running. Man, I'll tell you, Indy's never seen a driver like this. Okay, when he hits the craters and starts bouncing, it's when he gets his rooster tail. He makes sharp turns.
Then it was back to their lunar base, activate experiments, and close out EVA 1.
PY's exercise, is that right? Physical fitness, gym level?
Hey, that's right. Please don't take pictures of the hot dogs.
Showing the low residue, high protein diet.
On Earth, the scientists took a break. Tomorrow would be another busy day. April 22nd.
The lunar surface temperature in the sun should be around 135 degrees today.
Today they were headed a little over 4 kilometers south to climb their rover up the side of Stone Mountain.
Man, we are really going up a hill, I'll tell you.
Their first station, a crater 700 feet above their lunar module.
Wow, what a place. What a view, isn't it, John?
It's absolutely unreal.
really come up here, Tony. It's just spectacular. I have never seen it. All I can say is spectacular, and I know y'all are sick of that word, but that my vocabulary is so limited.
Well, let's see what we can do. If we got that rake soil, if we got certainly something, we could go to one-man sampling and maybe do it.
They would make a total of 6 stops on this traverse, collecting samples from large rocks down through the intermediates to the smallest soil particles. They would operate experiments measuring the strength of local magnetic fields to measuring the resistance of the soil to compaction.
How far away is that crater?
There you go. Man, we come a long way. Hey, John, it's easier to go straight across. That was fun.
But I haven't had any trouble.
Okay. I have a tough time walking up there.
The sampling time used up. It was time to return to the rover and head back to the lunar module.
And they did it in 2 minutes less travel time than they were pre-planned. Fantastic.
Tony, how about an extension, you guys? We feeling good. If Dad always going to do tonight was sit around and talk.
But with the limited oxygen and water in the backpacks, it was finally time to close out EVA 2.
Okay.
Now I think they realize that it's not more, a gee whiz, like my friend said, thrill, but it's real exploration, and this is much more serious and much more important for the future of mankind than just a plain exploit, a technical or technological exploit. This is exploration.
Ray Bradbury claims that what mankind sees in the exploration of space is his first chance at immortality since he invented religion.
That about gets it.
April 23rd. The decision had been made not to try and fix the broken heat flow experiment because of the time and complexities involved. Traverse number 3. Today, Young and Duke would head north about 5 kilometers to North Ray Crater, the largest lunar crater to be sampled by men.
Outstanding.
Hey, Tony, it seems to me this is a more subdued surface over here than going towards South Ray.
Oh, spectacular. Just spectacular.
Wow.
Sorry, Charlie.
Beautiful.
I gotta keep my eye on the driving.
That's great.
Jack, that's a good point to remember. All 3 crews now tend to think they're there before they get there.
I remember.
Man, does this thing have steep walls. They said 60 degrees. Now, I tell you, I can't see to the bottom of it, and I'm as close to the edge as I'm going to get. That's the truth.
Now, the routine, if anything on the moon can be called that. Test, collect, photograph. Keep moving. Time is precious on the moon.
They look like drill holes is what they look like. You do that in West Texas and you get a rattlesnake. Here you get permanently shattered soil.
How about rolling that one over?
No way.
Then, one of the most spectacular discoveries of the mission.
Look at the size of that biggie. It is a biggie, isn't it? It may be further away than we think. Because no, it's not very far. We're just right beyond you.
And we better press on for the big boulder.
Okay, we're headed that way. You get the tongs, John?
Yep, we got.
I carry the rake.
That big black dot.
Fantastic. It's like right here.
If we could see to the bottom, we could say for sure if this big black rock is right out of the bottom. But my guess from the old photographs is it probably is.
Okay, that sounds like a good guess.
God, you mean they weren't at it?
It looks like they were standing right there.
Look at the size of that rock.
Curious what they're going to look like when they stand next to it.
We can see.
Once I get to it, the bigger it is. Yeah, but look at the permanent shattered part, Charlie. On this side over here?
Yeah.
And as our crew slowly sinks, we bet upon it disappears into the sunset.
Well, Tony, that's your half rock right there.
Very good.
Don't get too near the edge of that thing. It falls off. Look over at your right. It falls off pretty good. Yeah, I know.
Yeah,
keep going.
Got it. I can't even. Okay, let's go on back. I am. Be right with you.
And we encourage you just to look for some variety.
But now it was time to head back to their base and close out the EVA.
All right, we think you could just about head south now.
Yeah, the only reason.
That's it. We're going, Home again, jiggity jig.
During the previous EVA, a section of a rear fender had come off the rover, causing the astronauts to receive occasional showers of lunar dirt.
And that's a beautiful sight.
Young parked the rover, then moved out to join Duke, enter the lunar module, and prepare for liftoff.
Boy, Houston, the beauty of this place is just absolutely incredible.
Smile, FAO. Don't be mad. We'll get it up there. See how nice and leisurely it's been? That's the way it should be, getting ready for ascent.
10 seconds.
What a ride. Pitch over's on time.
Together in orbit, the two spacecraft pirouetted, each inspecting the other.
This is one of the fastest maneuvers I've made in a long time.
The inspections complete, the command module and lunar module maneuvered to docking. John Young, Ken Mattingly, and Charlie Duke, reunited aboard the command module, settled down for tomorrow's tasks. Jettison the lunar module and burn out of orbit to come home. April 25. Ken Mattingly left the confines of the command module cabin, 173,000 miles from Earth. As he orbited the moon, he had not only made visual observations, he had been operating a complex series of experiments. Many of these had returned instant data to Houston. Two had taken thousands of high-resolution pictures of the lunar terrain. Now, Mattingly retrieved the film canisters and made his way back to the cabin with them, as Charlie Duke stood in the hatch to help him. It had been quite a mission. In John Young's words,
I think we've seen as much in 10 days as most people see in 10 lifetimes.
April 27. The last day. The crew looked out their windows through the 5,000-degree fireball of re-entry at their native planet.
Apollo 16 is in recovery. Welcome back, go ahead.
That is beautiful, isn't it?
Now they're blooming.
Beautiful.
There they are. Beautiful.
Apollo Control Houston, an observer on the Ticonderoga, estimates the distance from the ship about 1 mile.
Just got it on inside.
Hang on, John.
You saw an example of goal-oriented teamwork in action. The kind of thing that made this country great, and the kind of thing that's going to keep it that way.
A real smooth shot. Every bit of it, Gary.
You brought him in beautifully. Well done, young man. Outstanding.
I cannot touch that cigar anymore. I cannot.
I've told him they're going to improve the skyline. We're in trouble.
Mike, congratulations. Well done.
Yeah, we've got one more.
Well done.
One more to go.
We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. We set sail on this new sea because there is new knowledge to be gained and new rights to be won. And they must be won and used for the progress of all mankind. We shall send to the moon, 240,000 miles away from the control station in Houston, a giant rocket more than 300 feet tall, made of new metal alloys, some of which have not yet been invented, capable of standing heat and stresses several times more than have ever been experienced, fitted together with a precision better than the finest watch, carrying all the equipment needed for propulsion, guidance, control, communications, food, and survival, on an untried mission to an unknown celestial body. And therefore, as we set sail, we ask God's blessing on the most hazardous and dangerous and greatest adventure on which man has ever embarked. Thank you.
Like a person waiting in the wings to go on stage, they probably have less time to daydream because they're trying to remember what they've got to do. Well, I had a feeling that I really ought to concentrate on remembering the things that I had to do at the moon and all that.
Gosh, here we are, and we're getting down close. I hope the suit checks out okay. You get sweaty palms and heart starts pounding. It was like the big game about to start.
You're in your work clothes, ready to go to work. But you still have to stay there. You have to schedule it in conjunction with the booster schedule itself. You're plugged into the console. It's supplying 100% oxygen. It's kind of a catch-up time. If there's a problem with a booster or something, we're there and not sitting out the pad until the count gets to a certain point, and then we're called to proceed to the spacecraft.
back here now.
Right at the last minute, there was a psychological block in there that said, don't count on this so heavily. It might not happen. This is such a big thing. I frankly don't see how you can do it. Even when participating in it, I think it's audacious that you would try. I clearly could never understand, as a crewman, how to make it work. I could only learn how to operate my share of it. Being command pilot, I was sitting in the center seat, so that meant I climbed in last. I just stood around and waited until they strapped in. And here was a kind of a strange quiet. Look out and you can see the large part of the state and the ocean. And this thing out here, you have the feeling that it's alive. That's the kind of thing that sort of, for the first time, begins to bring home the fact that today is not the game we've been playing and training for years. This is reality. I had the only window at this point, and I looked out, and doggone if the moon wasn't visible in the daylight, right straight out the top of the window. I know they're doing their job right, because the moon's right straight ahead, and that's where we're pointed, and you know, they're just gonna launch us right straight to this thing.
This is Apollo Saturn Launch Control. All still go on the Apollo mission, the flight to land of the first men on the moon. Spacecraft also now is on full internal power. So up to this time, it had been sharing the load with an external power source. Once we get down to the 3-minute and 10-second mark in the countdown, we'll go on an automatic sequence. All aspects from there on down will be automatically run by the ground master computer here in the firing room.
Exactly. They don't have any place to carry it down.
He's not giving exactly. He's just looking across the flight plane to find out what the hell the trend is.
We have some 7.6 million pounds of thrust pushing the vehicle upwards. The vehicle weighs close to 6.5 million pounds.
We all are in this together as a team effort. We're gonna make it work. And I don't know how to make it work. I don't know how to do most of this mission, but I do know that I can assure you that my piece of it is gonna work, and you won't fail because of me.
The members of the launch team here in the control center monitoring a number of what we call red line values. These are tolerances we don't want to go above and below in temperatures and pressures. They're standing by to call out any deviations from our plans. All indications coming in to the control center at this time indicate we are go. The test supervisor now has informed launch vehicle test conductor you are go for launch. 3 minutes, 25 seconds and counting. We're still go at this time.
There's a long period of time where you've done all the things in the cockpit you can do, and there are very few things left to say. You don't know any new jokes to tell. There's just not much left to say except just sit there and wait.
It feels good.
Astronauts report it feels good. 1 minute, 25 seconds and counting. Our status board indicates the third stage completely pressurized. Guidance system goes on internal at 17 seconds, leading up to the ignition sequence at 8.9 seconds. Power transfer is complete.
Monitoring command coming in now. We are on the automatic sequence. T-minus 60 seconds and we're going to launch vehicle at this time. All the second stage tanks now pressurized. 35 seconds and counting.
Go.
It won't fail because of me.
T-minus 20 seconds and counting. Guidance internal. 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, engines on. 5, 4, 3, 2, econ. Launch commit.
Go.
Feels just like it sounds.
I got a pitch and a roll program, and this baby is really going.
Roger that. Stand by for mode 1 Bravo. Mark, 1 Bravo.
That's a lovely liftoff. That's not bad at all.
It's a moment there just of supreme elation, complete release of tensions. To feel all that power precisely directed, know that we're on course. First of all, for Earth orbit, and then precisely inserted onto the right orbit, right trajectory for rendezvous with the moon.
Apollo Houston, you're right smack dab on the trajectory. Your IU's doing a beautiful job.
I got a yaw program.
Trajectory's good. Thrust is good.
We're on our way, Houston.
At last, I'm leaving the Earth, and I'm destined for the moon.
What a ride. What a ride.
Roger. We copy, Pete.
Roger, looks good up here, too.
Roll's complete.
This is really a rock and roll ride.
You can feel it shake. There's a real strong vibration. Of course, you're up at the end of this beauty. Here you are going along with the G on you. It's up to about 4 Gs, but you're psyched to have good shape and all that. Even lifting your arm to move switches, no problem.
You are go for staging.
Here you are coming up on staging, and when staging happens, it's like, man.
We got the first step.
And S for ignition, Houston.
Ignition confirmed, thrust is go.
Roger. Trajectory guidance, CMC are all go. Thank you, Joe.
Houston, you're looking good here, right down the center line.
That was shut down, right on the money.
17, Houston, you are go for orbit. Go for orbit.
And we're out over the Canaries.
Follow Houston through the Canaries. How do you read?
Yeah, loud and clear, Houston, over the Canaries. Boy, it's just beautiful up here. Looking out the window, it's just really fantastic.
Roger.
Let me tell you a little bit about the ride.
John, this is Houston. If there's nothing startling to report about the ride, we'd rather hold off.
No, there's nothing really spectacular different to report on the ride. We'll hold off on that.
The sunset is just as beautiful as always in this space business.
In Africa, there are a lot of nomads out in the desert. Clear desert nights, you see the fires from all of these. These little yellow dots that represented fires from all of these nomads camping out. And you realize the broad area that you're looking at. And each of those little dots represented people, other humans that are out there in an environment which I would consider more strange than the environment they might think about me.
Get there in an orbit, engines shut down, and things sort of feel sort of funny, and you sort of unbuckle your seatbelt and wiggle around in your seat or tap your toes, and all of a sudden you're just bodies everywhere in the room, and you're just doing flips and cartwheels and spins.
Your first feelings of weightlessness as it hits you is like going down a country road about 60 miles an hour and a car goes over the bump and your stomach goes up into your throat, and then you get over the bump and you get that good sensation feeling, and then bomb, you're back down again. Only when you're in space and you go into weightlessness, you go over that bump and you never come down.
Problem. Can you give us a verb 96 enter to stop your integration? And we'd like you to do an EMOD dump. Give us a 3-2-1 mark when you do your verb 74. And if we get it done now, we should have an answer for you on your erasable memory by the time you get to Wimus. Do a verb 96 first.
We had a great deal of difficulty paying attention to what our job was. Already I was getting the impression that this is such an amazing thing that I'm going to forget these things. And no, I'm going to lose this image, it's going to be replaced with another. Each image came up, was there for a flash to be appreciated and savored, and then reluctantly let go because you know that it's going to be superposed with others.
And Houston, we're beginning to see a beautiful sunrise here.
Okay, we're giving you a go for your EVA at this time.
Okay, the hatch is open. No sweat. No, it stays just where I want
outside in one of those spacesuits, you're really in space. There are no boundaries to what you're seeing. It's like having a goldfish bowl over your head, which gives you unlimited visibility. And then the portable life support system is just very, very quiet. You know, there's a water pump in it that's circulating water through your underwear, you know, cooling water. And there's a fan that's pumping the oxygen through, but they're very quiet. You can't hear them at all. It's as if you're out there without anything on.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Houston.
Sort of total, complete silence and that beautiful view. And the realization, of course, that you're going 25,000 miles an hour. Recognize that you're not there because you deserve to be there. You were just lucky. You're the representative of humanity at that point in history, having that experience in a sense for the rest of mankind.
The flight director says get back in.
Apollo Control, Houston. 2 hours, 25 minutes ground elapsed time. It will be during this pass that we will have the translunar injection burn.
Capcom, we're go for TLI.
Roger. Guys, I've got the word you wanted to hear. You are go for TLI. You're go for the moon.
If there's anything to be a little bit remorseful about on going to the moon, it was that you didn't get a chance to spend as much time around the Earth as you'd like, because there's an awful lot of very interesting things to see.
3, 2, 1, ignition.
We confirm ignition, and the thrust is go.
You guys are really hauling the mail out of there.
Oh, you better believe it. It's like we're climbing straight out, Joe. It's a fantastic sight. It's like we were shot straight up.
You're going about 6,000 feet a second.
Present altitude is now about 3,000 miles. Spacecraft moving at nearly 35,000 feet per second. These three crew members are traveling faster than man has ever flown before.
There's not much sensation of what's really happening, except that we're looking at the computer, and the computer is adding up the velocity. And suddenly, we really knew that we were really traveling. And shoot, when that engine lit off, it was on for a long time.
Shutdown.
But it really hit us when it stopped, when we turned around and looked at the Earth. Suddenly, the Earth had started to shrink.
Tape recorder on board, which you could listen to the music. We were allowed to carry a personal cassette on there so you could play the music. Mine was country music.
Hi, this is Buck Owens from the Buckaroos. We came down to the studio and we thought we'd put together a little thing that you could take along with you on your trip. Now, you know, when you get back, they're probably going to put you in the movies. So the first thing we're going to do for you is to play a little song called Act Naturally. It goes like this. They're going to put me in the movies. They're going to make a big star out of me. Well, we'll make a scene about a man that's sad and lonely. And all I got to do is act naturally. Well, I'll bet you I'm going to be a big star. You might win an Oscar, you can't ever tell. The movies are gonna make me a big star, 'cause I can play the part so well. Well, I hope you'll come to see me in the movie, and I know that you're gonna play the scene. The biggest fool that's ever hit the big time. And all I gotta do is act naturally. By the way, gang, you know we're making this tape, and they're going to the moon. They're on the way to the moon right now.
Oh.
Anybody up there, read me. This is Houston.
You don't think of it as Texas or the United States. You really think of it as Earth. The three things that I associated with Earth were people and green trees and fresh water.
This is something a little different from England. My name is Merle Haggard, and this is my band, The Strangers.
And I hope that we will be able to do something you'll enjoy hearing on your way to the moon. And, of course, we hope that you come back. But we want you to leave this tape there, okay? We want this tape to be out of sight.
Someday, when our green world finds us, these hard times are gone. We'll laugh and count our blessings in a mansion all our own. If we both pull together, tomorrow's sure to come. Someday we'll look back and say it was fun.
You get ready to eat, it'll say right on there, command module pilot, day 3, meal 2. And so you take that packet out, and you may have 2 drinks and 3 or 4 different types of food in there. So you've got to find a spot to stick these, or they're going to float off. And then you've got to get the water gun. You got to mix up the drinks and mix up the food and knead them around and not let everything float off in the interim.
Someday we'll look back and say it was fun. Someday when our dream world finds us, this hard time.
The only bad part about zero gravity in Apollo was going to the bathroom. We had a very crude system. For your feces, it was a bag. And you put this bag in the right position. So you go, but the only thing is that nothing goes to the bottom of the bag in zero gravity. Everything floats. So you've got this bag, and then the problem is getting it off and closing up the bag, making sure everything's still in the bag.
Someday we'll look back and say that a good time on the way to the moon didn't.
TV now. We're standing by.
Hello, Houston. We've got a beautiful view of the Earth here, but it's absolutely fantastic.
Now we're standing by at this time to receive
the
first television transmission from the spacecraft.
Houston, we're now showing you a view of the Earth through the telephoto lens. This transmission is coming to you approximately halfway between the moon and the Earth.
It makes you realize just what you have back there on Earth. The Earth from here is a grand oasis of the big vastness of space.
What I keep imagining is if I'm some lonely traveler from another planet, would I land on the blue or the brown part of the Earth?
Okay, world, hold on to your hat. I'm going to turn you upside down.
Now, the spacecraft at the present time is in a slow roll as part of the passive thermal control program to maintain temperatures.
You have to literally just pinch yourself and ask yourself the question silently, do you really know where you are at this point in time and space and in reality and in existence? When you look out the window and you're looking back at the most beautiful star in the heavens, the most beautiful because it's the one we understand and we know, it's we're home, it's humanity, it's people, family, love, life. And besides that, it is beautiful. You can see from pole to pole and across oceans and continents, and you can watch it turn, and there's no strings holding it up, and it's moving in a blackness that is almost beyond conception.
How's that tape recorder? Is the RPM up to nominal?
Yeah, it works pretty good here in 0G. It works better than it does down there on the ground.
We're ready for the news now.
Okay, let's see. The Beatles have announced they will no longer perform as a group. The quartet is reported to have made in excess of $500 million during their short musical career. However, rumors that they will use this money to start their own space program are false.
That's about it for news. A recap of the top 10 teams did yesterday. Ohio State beat Purdue 42-14. Texas beat TCU 69-7. Tennessee lost to Mississippi. Final score on that one was 38-0. Notre Dame won over Georgia Tech last night 38-20. And of course, Purdue lost to Ohio State.
When the sunlight shines through the blackness of space, it's black. But I was in sunlight and I was able to look at this blackness. I mean, what are you looking at? Call it the universe, but it's the infinity of space and the infinity of time. I'm looking at something called space that had no end, and at time that has no meaning. You can really focus on it because you've got this planet out there, the star called Earth, which itself is in its blackness, but it is lit up because the sunlight strikes on an object, strikes on something called Earth. And it's not a hostile blackness. Maybe it's not hostile because of the beauty of the Earth that sort of gives it life.
Throughout the flight, the times when one could sit back and really appreciate what an amazing adventure this was only during those little periods of time when you had a chance to stop and do the things which you weren't programmed to do. A lot of times when there was nothing else to do or after everybody going to sleep and I'd open up the window and look around. One thing every spacecraft ought to have is a huge window. Looking back at the Earth was a pastime that I never really got tired of.
Who have you got up now?
The other two guys are pretty sleepy. They sacked out again, so I'm closing the fort down for a while.
Biomedical data recently was monitored, and the CMP was soundly asleep while the commander was resting, but perhaps not soundly asleep.
You got the Black Watch watching you tonight.
You picked up the night shift, I see.
Yeah, it's turning out to be kind of quiet, too.
We like it that way.
When you're out there in this little command module, you see the risk you're taking because you realize that if the blast breaks or if the computers quit working or the electrical system quits working, you're not going to get back. And you have time to contemplate this. You have time to think about it, and you have time to run it through your mind a lot of different times.
How far away from Earth now, Jim, about?
It looks like you're approaching 150,000 miles. Frank, we had a little eggnog over at Charlie Duke's tonight. Val Anders dropped by. She's looking fine. Tell Bill she's doing real well.
Right. Thank you.
Everything that I know, my family, my possessions, my friends, my country, it's all down there on that little thing. And it's so insignificant in this great big vastness of space.
Here in Mission Control, the coffee cup has become an appliance second only to the headset in usefulness here.
Let's cycle through some of our consumables and other items this morning and tell you what we see. And all this looks quite normal.
Lights, camera, action.
We'll show you some of the type meals that we have on Earth. Matter of fact, on this flight, we've carried along pieces of bread. And along with the bread, we have a ham spread. And I'll show you, I hope, how easy it is to spread some ham. Environment of zero G.
that we've discovered that it is quite easy to...
I'm surprised you all haven't sent us the music.
Well, you want music.
This little tape recorder has been a big benefit to us in passing some of the time away in our transit out to the moon. And it's rather odd to see it floating like this in Odyssey while it's playing the theme from 2001.
Oxygen in the service module, which provides breathing oxygen for the crew. Apollo Houston, try SCE to auxiliary, over.
SCE to auxiliary.
SCE to auxiliary.
Okay, let's make sure that we don't do anything that's going to blow our CSM electrical power with the batteries or that will cause us to lose fuel cell number two.
Under instrumentation power control. Open CB number 3 and number 4. Close the SN feed 1 and 2 circuit breakers. Cycle the Parker valve and then open the SN feed circuit breakers on panel 11.
Hey, it's off. It's off.
That sounds beautiful, troops. It's exactly what we wanted to see.
Early, my hat's off to the guys in the trench. I love them.
And by the way, welcome to the moon's fair. You're in the infrared.
One of the things different about a lunar trip is you don't pass any place on the way. Going to the moon, you leave the launch pad, then you leave Earth orbit, and then a couple of days later, after passing nothing, all of a sudden you're at the moon. And that lack of waypoints, to me, had an effect of making it seem a little magical or mystical getting there.
This is really a rugged planet.
We're drawing closer to the moon with the Apollo spacecraft. Our LOS clock, loss of signal clock, continues to count down until that time that the spacecraft will pass out of communications range over the backside of the moon. On approach, the spacecraft sort of dives towards and behind the moon.
It was a totally different moon than any moon I had ever seen before. It was in this eerie shadow, no motion, utterly silent. It sort of gave one a feeling of foreboding. It didn't seem like a very friendly or welcoming place.
Apollo, this is Houston. Your go for LOI.
Go ahead, Houston.
Jim, you are go for the burn. Go for the burn.
Okay, Apollo 8 is go.
You're going too fast to orbit the moon. You're rocking on ready.
Hey, 2 minutes, babe. Give it a final trim. Burn time is 15 seconds, so it's going to go in a hurry.
You're in the burn position. You're ready to go.
Baby, let's make this one.
Then you look, and there it is.
35 seconds.
It's 2001 type stuff. The old moon's just growing magnificently fast, and it's just filling up that hatch window, and you're drifting into the shadow.
Okay, baby. 8, 7, 6, 5, 3, 2, 1, burn.
Burn. You're burning.
More to go. You're burning. 200 to go. Okay.
beautiful.
Charlie Houston, he got the burn off. We're in good shape.
Well, I tell you, we is down among them, going backwards. You know that?
You've worked so long and so hard, and finally you're here. The burn has gone well. You know you're in lunar orbit. You know the orbit is good. You're right where you wanted to be. I mean, it just looked like you could reach out and touch it.
Apollo now traveling over the backside of the moon. The crew should be seeing the features, the rugged features, moving below them at a high rate of speed.
Charlie, we just saw Earth's eyes, and it's got to be magnificent.
Charlie, it might sound corny, but the view is really out of this world.
Okay, Davey, you ought to start getting your hatch closed.
Say again?
You ought to start getting your hatch closed if you're not already doing it.
I was disappointed. I wanted to go there so bad I could taste it. As far as I was concerned, that was what it was all about. Not only going to the moon, but going down the surface and walking.
We're now less than 2 minutes away from the separation burn, which will be performed by the command module. When next we hear from them, the lunar module should be undocked from the command and service module.
You'll never know how big this thing gets when there ain't nobody in here but one guy.
Yeah, don't get lonesome out there, John.
I wish I could go down there with him. You may not talk about it very much, but part of your training is coming back by yourself.
See you later.
Wish the damn thing could hold three people.
Grown quite quiet here in Mission Control. A few moments ago, Flight Director Gene Kranz requested that everyone sit down, get prepared for events that are coming, and he closed with good luck to all of you.
It's going. We is down among us, Charlie.
Roger, I hear you weaving your way up the freeway.
You're going right down US 1, Mike.
Roger, copy. Looks great.
Okay, all flight controllers, go, no go for landing. Retro.
Go.
Econ.
Go.
Surgeon.
Go.
Fido.
Go.
Guidance.
Go.
Patrol.
Go.
Telcom.
Go.
GNC.
Go.
Capcom, we're go for landing.
Eagle, Houston, you're go for landing. Over.
Okay, Houston, we'll give you a countdown. 4, 3, 2, 1, fire.
There it is.
Oh, baby.
Fish, you're coming down to that ground.
look at that rill. That's gotta be probably Diamondback right there.
When it pitches over and you get your first look, you know, there was nothing but 9 million craters after a terrible sinking feeling. Obviously didn't recognize a thing after studying all these photographs. Nothing looked right.
How you doing, Control?
We look good here, fine.
Roger, how about you, Telcom?
Go.
Guidance, you happy?
Go.
Fido.
Go.
Roger, you're a go. You go to continue power descent. You're a go to continue power descent.
Roger.
All during this power descent, I kept telling myself, Jim, this is not for real. You're back in the simulator. Just remember that.
Eagle, Houston, it's descent to fuel to monitor. Over. Eagle, Houston, everything's looking good here. Over.
Houston, I'm getting a little fluctuation in the AC voltage now.
Roger. Stand by. Looking good to us. You're still looking good.
Houston, you're looking at our Delta H.
That's affirmative. Looking good to us. Over. Eagle, Houston, we'll monitor your Delta H.
Beautifully.
6+25, throttle down. 6+25, throttle down.
Roger, copy. 6+25.
Let me try auto again now, see
what happens.
We got data dropout. Roger, stand by.
We're going, that alarm? If it doesn't reoccur, we'll be go.
We're going, that alarm.
Roger, understand. Go for landing.
Roger, we got good data.
Altitude, velocity, light.
Eagle, we got you now. It's looking good. Over.
Four forward, drifting to the right a little. Coming down to 23. 21 down, 33 degrees.
We're go, same tide, we're go.
Picking up some dust.
And a couple of big boulders.
Coming right, got a good spot.
Not too bad. There comes a shadow.
Oh, are we coming in? Stand by for touchdown. Stand by. Base here. The Eagle has landed.
There's a cheer in this room. What we're witnessing now is man's the very first trip in a space with a station stop along the route.
We got a stay, Houston.
This thing came to a stop on the moon. There was kind of a letdown saying, you know, we're going to have to get it going fast again to get back home.
Neil, this is Houston. What's your status on hatch opening?
Okay, Houston, I'm on the porch.
Neil, this is Houston. Loud and clear. Radio check and verify TV circuit breaker in.
Roger, TV circuit breaker's in.
Houston, Roger, we copy, and we're standing by for your TV.
I'm gonna pull it now. Houston, the Mesa came down, all right.
And we're getting a picture on the TV.
Got a good picture.
Hey, Neil, we can see you coming down the ladder now.
But the surface appears to be very, very fine-grained as you get close to it. I'm at the foot of the ladder. Yeah, I'm gonna step off the limb now. That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
I had a bet with somebody who didn't really felt that Neil spent a great deal of time before he went figuring out his famous words, and they were not extemporaneous on the spot historical words. He actually felt that these words might have even been written for Neil by somebody else. And I said, well, I'll bet you $500 that when I get to the bottom of the ladder and nobody ever remembers what the second person to do something does anyhow, I'm going to say it may have been a small step for Neil, but it's a big step for a little fellow like me.
Ready for me to come out?
Okay.
Now I want to back up and partially close the hatch, making sure not to lock it on my way out.
So this person said, no way you're going to do that. I'm going to tell you what to say. Okay, bet's a bet. So I bet this person $500. So when I got to the bottom of the ladder, I said,
man, that may have been a small one for Neil, but that's a long one for me.
12 Houston, we have you in blushing black and white.
What happened to the color?
Maybe the color wheel was hung up.
I can feel the wheels running because I can feel something in motion inside.
Why don't you go put your glove in front of the lens?
All right, we'll do.
That's coming in there now, Al.
Got the old camera running.
Okay, what change did you make?
I hit it on the top with my hammer. I figured we didn't have a thing to lose.
I can't believe it.
Oh, well, watch this.
I don't know if this will work or not, Charlie.
Well, in my left hand, I have a feather. In my right hand, a hammer. And I guess one of the reasons we got here today was because of a gentleman named Galileo a long time ago who made a rather significant discovery about falling objects in gravity fields. And we thought that where would be a better place to confirm his findings than on the moon. And so we thought we'd try it here for you. The feather happens to be appropriately a falcon feather for our falcon. And I'll drop the two of them here, and hopefully they'll hit the ground at the same time. How about that? That proves that Mr. Galileo was correct in his findings.
We got a beautiful picture of you guys up down there.
Let me tell you, Bob, this flag is a beautiful picture. Hey, John, this is perfect with the limb, you, and the old flag.
You really should set the flag up on a hill, Charlie, but there just ain't one.
I know, John.
Put it right here. Big rock.
I was proud for our country more than I was proud for me. It was nothing that I did. I just happened to have gotten there at the right time. My background carried me through. But there were a lot of other qualified people that didn't go. Why my name came out, I don't know. Like sitting in the last row of the balcony, looking down for that play going on. While I was in the play, it was more like I was a spectator.
Tranquility, this is Houston. We'd like to say from all of us down here in Houston, and really from all of us in all the countries and in the entire world, we think that you've done a magnificent job up there today. Over.
Thank you very much. Have you had enough TV for today?
Yes, indeed. It's been a mighty fine presentation there.
Thank you. Couldn't have enjoyed it as much as we did.
Get some rest there and have at it tomorrow.
Okay, signing off. See you again tomorrow.
All systems on the lunar module are in good order. We have not heard from Tranquility Base since saying goodnight.
My mind's one that just goes constantly. So I took a sleeping pill. Slept like a baby. I had one dream that was very vivid. In my dream, we were driving a rover up to the north. And you didn't really feel like you were out there. It was untouched. The serenity of it had a pristine purity about it. We crossed a hill. I felt, gosh, I've been here before. And there was a set of tracks out in front of us. And so we asked Houston if we could follow the tracks. And they said yes. So
and we turned and followed the tracks. Within an hour or so, we found this vehicle. It looked just like the Rover, two people in it. They looked like me and John. Had been there for thousands of years. Not a nightmare type situation, nothing like that. Probably one of the most real experiences in my life.
I'd have traded on a drop of a hat to go land on the moon. I'm one of these nuts. I like classical music. And I almost learned to like country and western. One of the things I took was Berlioz's Symphony Fantastique, which seemed like that was an appropriate thing to be taken to the moon. And I was floating along, just laying back and enjoying life. I just crossed the face of the moon, going towards the darkness. And here's this strange scene, this music. And it just seemed to put it all together in one moment that you could completely forget that this is a real situation.
This is Apollo Control Houston at 104 hours, 31 minutes now into this historic mission.
The lunar surface temperature in the sun should be around 135 degrees today. In the shade, the temperature would again be about minus 100 to minus 150 degrees Fahrenheit. That would be in the shadow of the lunar module.
Oh, look at that. It's a panoramic scene of beauty. Al, can you find yours? Oh, there it is. I can see it.
Looking at the Earth down there, Houston, it looks like you're littler than a golf ball at arm's length now. Sure looks pretty, though. Really looks spectacular.
Seemed very unreal to me to be there, looking back at the Earth and thinking how far, far away it was. This is the moon, that is the Earth. I'm really here.
We're allowing about 5 minutes for the drive to station three.
Okay, safety belt foot. And here we go.
How's it driving, John? Pretty easy?
Driving good.
And I'll tell you, Andy's never seen a driver like this. Barney Oldfield.
Charlie, what should we be heading for?
Those craters up there.
Oh, don't tell me that.
Boy, this is so neat. You look like you hit it just about for our spot. See Survey Ridge down there?
Yeah.
This is gonna be spectacular. No, not through this crater. Yeah. Woo!
Trying to see if you're nervous, Charlie.
Oh, Barney's really driving this beauty.
Only way to fly, Tony.
And boy, this is going to be such a spectacular view, you can't believe it.
Well, that's good news.
We are here.
You did it. Hey, that was a good stop. Those wheels just locked. Mark off.
Super.
John, did you dust that TV lens?
Get some dirt in your eye, Houston.
Hey, that does a good job on the lens there.
You want us to go up and travel along that ridge?
Yeah, why don't you press on up there?
I think that the best place here for the ALSEP is to the LIM 11 o'clock position.
That sounds good, Charlie. And John, it's 266.
I felt very welcome there. You know, the moon's been waiting for us for thousands of years. Millions of years, maybe. Unless someone else has already been there before us at some time, that's possible. Although we didn't see any evidence of that. Felt like I was the only one there, but not an alien. Not an alien in terms of invading someone else's domain. I didn't find the moon hostile, or I found it very majestically beautiful. Bland in color, but majestically beautiful.
There's a look at that glass-covered one right there, John.
Pretty good size, isn't it?
Yeah. It looks like it's about 3 days old, so it must be on the order of 4 billion. Let's fill this one up, and then, rat. Bet you that looks like a comedy of errors on a tube. Yeah. Hold still. That is a crystalline rock, if I've ever seen a crystalline rock.
First one today.
Yeah. We gotta get over this ridge, John. You wanna take off and go that way now? Yeah. Hey, John, did you make those little footprints here around the sun?
Yeah, I guess I did.
Sure I did. Ah, the old footprints on a crater rim. There's a good rock right there. Look at the size of that rock. I thought this thing was just right next door to us. Well, Tony, that's your house rock right there. It's got black streaks coming out of it. Man, this is tough going here. Now, let me have a shovel. Oh, I get it, man. Just a minute. Good deal, boy. There you go. I can't get going here.
Okay, and you've got about 10 minutes left before we'll have to leave.
Is that okay for you?
Yep, sure is.
338 is the soil sample. That is the best sample we got.
I know it.
I'll tell you.
You just had to steal time now and then. You just had to stop chipping at a rock and figure out that bringing back a little bit of some kind of thought and feeling was as important as bringing another chunk of rock back. And not being a machine, but being a human being, you have to stop and say, do you know where you are and what you're looking at? And try and take in those few moments of privacy you have, everything there is to take in that moment.
And you've got 5 minutes here.
And all of a sudden, you've got to get to work.
Okay, Houston, as I stand out here in the wonders of the unknown in Hadley, I realize there's a fundamental truth to our nature. Man must explore.
One of the things you got to stop and do, make sure, is to have fun, too. Because you're only probably going to come this way once.
I was strolling on the moon one day in a merry, merry month of December.
Now,
May, when much to my surprise, a pair of bunny eyes.
Boy, is this a neat way to travel.
Isn't it great?
Dum-da-dum-dum-dum. Dum-da-dum-dum-dum. Dum-da-dum-dum-dum.
I like to skip along.
Not me, boy. Skip.
Or whatever you call it.
It was almost dangerous. You lose sight of the fact that it's a vacuum out there, and if you spring a leak next to it, you're gonna be dead.
Uh-oh.
Having gotten away from the spacecraft, I was able to really realize what this place was like that we had landed in. I had tried to anticipate what it would be like for many years, but it was obvious that there was no way one could have anticipated what it would be like to stand in the valley of Taurus Littoral, a place deeper than the Grand Canyon and equally as spectacular, see this brilliantly illuminated landscape with a brighter sun than anyone had ever stood in before, with a blacker than black sky. And then to top the whole scene off in this blacker than black sky was a beautiful, brilliantly illuminated blue marble that we call the Earth. The path of evolution is now in space, as much as on Earth. Man has showed that as a species, mankind was willing to commit itself to living in environments that were completely different than those in which the species evolved. Put a shield of life around ourselves in order to protect the life within, but the willingness to go out there is there. We've shown that. The curve of human evolution has been bent.
Okay, then it's time to load up right now.
Hey, we're underway again, Tony.
Okay, we'd like you to drive gingerly up to the ALSEP area there.
Okay, we're going up.
We'll go right or left.
We want to head, just keep going west.
Oh, I'm sorry, look to left. Gonna expect trouble from backseat drivers.
Okay, we copy that, huh?
Look at this baby. I'm really getting confidence in it now.
This back wheel's off the ground.
Charlie, whatever you do, don't hit that brake.
The Grand Prix driver's at it again.
This is about the neatest thing I ever saw.
Back to the limb, right, Tony?
You bet your life. And you're well ahead on the timeline. You've been making good time.
He must have forgot something. Sure. Yeah, so I'm like,
well, everything's running. We're just about to start up slope here. Have we been climbing, John? Look at that pitch meter. Pegged out high.
Hey, we have been climbing.
Tony, it doesn't feel like we're climbing, but we've been climbing for quite a while here. And we're going up a steep, steep slope, John. I'll tell you.
Look at that, Charlie.
I don't see one. What?
Well, I'll be doggone.
Look at that.
Charlie, you said you were going to see some other tracks on the moon.
I knew it. Hey, we're going back down our tracks, Tony.
Okay, good show.
There she is, John.
Somebody up there likes us.
Don't run into our hole.
I felt like I was an alien as I traveled through space. But when I got on the moon, I didn't feel that at all. I felt at home there, even though the Earth was a long ways away. We could see it directly above, about the size of a marble, and realize that we're there. But by the grace of God, I felt like I was at the end of a thin cord that could be cut at any time. It was precarious, but yet I felt comfortable. I felt something other than just what we can visually sense. A spiritual presence was there. Perhaps it was because so many people on the earth were focusing their attention. They were maybe sending signals to us somehow. I sensed, I guess in a way, much like maybe the first man on the earth would have sensed, like Adam and perhaps Eve, as they were standing on the earth and they realized they were all alone. There was no one else on the earth, but yet they had that special communication. And I guess it was similar to the feeling I had on the moon when I realized that Dave Scott and I were the only two on this vast planet, another world. We were the only two there. We felt an unseen love. We were not alone.
Some 7 minutes, 22 seconds away from ignition on the limb ascent back into lunar orbit.
Capcom? Ecom. Surgeon. GNC.
Guidance, you happy?
Go.
Fido.
Go.
AFD. We don't have an AFD.
No. FAL.
Network. Recovery.
Capcom, we're go for liftoff.
Tranquility Base, Houston, you're cleared for takeoff.
Roger, understand. We're number one on the runway.
The moon is different. It's become man's first outpost, our first footstep in space, where man was able to look back at the Earth and see the Earth and see himself in a different perspective.
6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, ignition.
As you leave, you're leaving this unbelievably beautiful, naked, charcoal ball out there in space. And you've been around the moon. You've been on it. And you're seeing something that's familiar to you. That's home. That's where we live. There's where we left the lunar rover, and there's where we explored, and there's the mountains and the valleys. And it is, in a sense, has been a home, a life-sustaining home for you. And when you leave it and you see those things, you leave it with the same kind of feeling and awe that you left the Earth with several days earlier.
30 minutes from rendezvous in the command module, Pete said to me, "You want to fly this thing?" And I said, "Well, yeah, I'd like to fly it." As I took the controls, I thought, "Well, wait a minute. The people on Earth in Mission Control aren't going to like this." And to show how he thinks about things, he said,
Houston, you're looking good to us.
Roger, Houston, we are returning to the Earth. Over.
Glad to have you on the way back home.
I think I must have a...
We set sail on this new sea because there is new knowledge to be gained and new rights to be won, and they must be won and used for the progress of all mankind.
As time goes on, I truly do believe that you're able to pull out of the subconscious a great many things that you absorbed in those moments while you were there looking back at the Earth. And I can almost transform my body, certainly my mind, through time and space instantaneously to that spot on the moon. I know where I am when I look at the moon. It's not just some abstract romantic idea. It's something very real to me. Stars are my home.